I had like a rather traumatic experience that kind of opened my eyes to writing. So from the very beginning, I was writing in a therapeutic way. Like writing was a way of kind of not just escaping, but kind of going inward. It's always been like that for me. And so what's kind of made me continue was that after discovering writing, after this traumatic experience, I took a creative writing class. And when I took that class, I really learned that I love storytelling and that I was really good at it. And from that point on, I've continued to do it. And so so it's not just the love of storytelling, it's just kind of being aware of the world around me and the stories around me and telling those stories in really creative, interesting ways. So that's really kind of what drives me in a very broad sense. Who Fears Death was inspired by the passing of my father. And, you know, my family and I were all very close. I was very close with my father, and it was a traumatic time for me. And so, as I said before, writing has always been sort of therapeutic thing. So when I'm really happy, I write, but also when I'm really distraught and sad, I write as well. So I started writing this like literally the night after my father's wake keeping. And I didn't outline at all. Like it wasn't a novel that I had planned to write. I didn't know who the character was. All I know is that evening, I sat down and started writing this bit of story about this character who was at her father's grave and looking down at her father, not his grave, at her father's wake keeping, looking down at her father's face and thinking that doesn't look like him anymore. And just, she was in a really emotional state. It was basically autobiographical. So I just started writing the story, and in the story, it just kind of took over. It took over, and this voice came to me, and this character came to me, and this character kind of took the place of me in the story, and I just went with that. And so the way that I constructed the story was very interesting, because I wrote that beginning chapter, but then I wrote another chapter that was near the end, and then I wrote the middle, and then I went back to the end, and I just kind of jumped around until I had a cohesive story if you put all the pieces together. And then I put all that together and then edited and edited and edited. So it was a very strange but very organic process. And it's one that I've since, that's how I write now. It's in that kind of non-linear way. It's set in the distant future, but things are still similar to, like, humanity is still recognizable. It's set in a distant future, it's set in a part of Africa. So because it's a distant future, it's, you know, African borders have shifted and everything, but if we were to think about the exact geographical location, it would be in the Sudan. This time, in this land, there is a lot of political strife going on. There's genocide happening between Arab-looking people and African-looking people, the Okeke and the Nuru. And our main character is a product of rape. So she is born from that, and her mother takes her far away from the worst part of it and raises her in this town that is mostly African. And she comes up in this town, and eventually our main character becomes something more and returns to those problems. And tries to fix them in some way. So that's really the thrust of the story. There's a lot more going on, but that's the heart of it. The story, it's post-apocalyptic. So something has happened, and I know exactly what that is. Something has happened to the Earth that has made the Earth the way it is. It's very desert. You know, everything, most things are dead. The land seems to be dead, mostly dead. And something happened to cause that. And that something was due to human beings. So take that into consideration and then move into the future. A lot of the problems that humanity has now are going to kind of manifest themselves again in a similar way in the future. So that's when I'm coming into the story understanding. And then I'm also coming into the story understanding that the mystical and the mundane coexist. So there will be mystical incidents and mystical things happening in the future. So I take those two ideas and you get Who Fears Death. Onyesonwu's story is a personal story, but it's also a story that is epic. It affects and just even with the way that the narrative is constructed, what she does affects everybody. And really, it's not a chosen one narrative. It's not okay, she is the only one who can do this. There are many, many characters who are necessary for changing the world in this story, but this is her story. So she's telling her story in her own voice. But this is her story, and it's part of the world. So what she does affects the world. So it's within and it's outside. It's the personal and it's the community. I think that African literature is going to open up, is opening up. And what I mean by opening up is we have greats and classics like Things Fall Apart or books by a lot of the classic African authors. And a lot of those tend to focus on problems in Africa, which and so those narratives are very necessary, and those narratives are great reads as well. Back then, okay, so those narratives were really the only narratives coming out of Africa, and that was problematic in that there are, first of all, Africa is huge. It's a huge continent. It has many countries. It has many diverse cultures, it would be assumed that it has many stories, many types of stories, and up till recently, I think a lot of those types of stories were not being heard. We were just hearing one type of story, and now I think that we're going to be hearing a greater diversity of stories, and I think that's where the science fiction and fantasy genre in Africa, or by African writers both in Africa and in the diaspora, comes in is really important. And I think that is opening up now. African writers and African writers of the diaspora are feeling more permission to not even permission, because they don't need permission, feeling more confident in telling these different types of stories. I think there's always been that want. I think there's always been that want, but like there's been this push to tell one or a very few types of African narratives, and I think the time has come where we're gonna be seeing more. Thank goodness. I will write the stories that I write. I'm not, it's not about validation for me at all. I was writing these stories before anyone even heard of me, before anyone was even reading me, and that hasn't changed at all. But what has changed is the knowledge that there are lots of people out there who not only are reading what I'm writing, but enjoying it and understanding it and kind of having a hunger for these types of narratives. So that's really, That's really nourishing for me as a writer. That type of validation has given me a little more confidence in opening it up even more and taking more risks. So there's that. I mean, it's not that I wasn't taking risks before, but I have a lot of ideas. I have a lot of strange ideas, and now I feel like and where I would have written those anyway, now I feel like it's that there are lots of people who actually would want to read those, which is a really cool thing for a writer to know. So I think that HBO is a perfect place for a book like Who Fears Death, or for Who Fears Death, because of their ability to take risks, because Who Fears Death is a risky book. It's a heavy narrative, and it's a type of narrative that has never been done, especially as in terms of TV and in terms of film. It has never been done, and because it's never been done, there's no template to follow, and so HBO is the perfect place for Who Fears Death to be. I think that working with George R. R. Martin is perfect as well, because he comes with a plethora of knowledge. He just knows so many different types of writing, and he knows a lot about TV, obviously, and he's a risk taker as well, and so he's unafraid, and it's really good to work with people who are unafraid, especially for this, because, well, it's called Who Fears Death.